Yeah?
I know they probably don't need to make me be on because I'm too loud already. Great to see you guys. Let's just give God some glory for what he's doing in the lives of our students. You know, the enemy wants us to be a friend of the world, so it's a victory when they can become friends with other brothers and sisters in the Lord. And that's always a good thing to see each other at school, to see each other. And I think that that's a big part of our church is fellowship is a very important part of what we understand. It's that walking in that wholeness before God that he gives us one another. Real quick, I just got to give a shout out to my dad. Dad, happy birthday yesterday. I love you. We miss you. And I'll call you again later today. So anyways, you know, the German philosopher Kant said that there are three questions which mankind has always been asking. What can I know? What shall I do? And for what may I hope? Google defines hope as a feeling of expectation and a desire for a certain thing to happen. Now, that's great, but what's the Bible say? What's the Bible have to say about what hope is? I love the contemporary English version of the way it puts what hope is in from Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. Would you read this out loud with me? Let's read this together. Ready? Faith makes us sure of what we hope for and gives us proof of what we cannot see. Circle we. Now, we all have hope. And we're going to talk about that hope today because it's what we put our hope in and what we do with our hope that makes the difference with what hope really is. And I want to touch on that today, and I'm going to stretch a lot of you today because it's how I've been stretched. What I'm preaching today is what I have learned. What I've learned as a Christian, what I've learned as a pastor. You guys got to realize what happens in my world, what happens in my life. I see all the good, all the bad, all the dark, all the light. I see the reality of this thing that we call Christianity. Not that you don't, but I live it each and every day. And it could be some pretty heavy stuff. But God allows that and shows me that, and I walk through the same stuff that you guys do, so that when we come together, my life can help share those experiences and help take God's word and bring an understanding to it. Because hope is a funky thing. I mean, hope is one of those things people can take it and make it whatever they want. Hope is hard to understand. What is hope? Hope, I hope. Right? It's just one of those things. I want to bring an understanding to what hope is because some people say, just have hope. What's that really mean? I'm going through, I just found out I have cancer and I have 5 days to live. Well, just have hope. Thank you. What's that mean? Right? And so, what does everyone hope for? Not so much live for, but what do they live for with, you know, not just living for, but also what do you hope for? Not just for life forever, but there'll be no more pain, right? That's what I hope. I don't want any more pain. I don't want any more problems. I don't want any more hurt in life. That, I mean, you don't talk about hope. But, I mean, what's the ultimate? What do people hope for? Where can you find that hope then? So, is what you hope for all that there is? I want you to write this down. A life without Easter is a life without hope. If there was no Easter, we wouldn't have hope. You could put hope in things, but that doesn't mean that hope is going to materialize. That doesn't mean what you hope for is going to happen. You can put your faith and your hope in all kinds of stuff, but without Easter, the reality is eternity and the greatest hope that you could ever hope for really won't happen. See, through Easter, Jesus provides a true hope. The Assyrians, Babylonians, the Phoenicians, Egyptians, Persians, Greeks, Romans, all of them had their many, many gods. They had gods of war. They had gods of industry. They had gods of agriculture, gods of cities, gods of towns, all kinds of various gods. But all of the pagan gods, all of their galaxy of gods that they had, there was never one that was called a god of hope. Did you know that? They've never had a god of hope. But the fact is, there is no hope for this world apart from Jesus. Apart from the true Lord, the God, the creator of the universe, Jesus Christ. Look at Romans 15, verse 13. It tells us this. May the God of what? The God of what? Fill you with all joy and peace and trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. There is a God of hope. He came. And he came at just the perfect time in humanity to come and declare, there is a God of hope, and he is the Lord God. There is only one God, and this one God is a God of hope. I want to tell you, that's the beauty of baptism. If you have not been baptized, get baptized. If you are a believer and follower of Jesus Christ, get baptized. Why? Jesus said to do it. And it shows, it's a public profession, showing people, I found hope. That I'm not just going to die, but I'm going to be cleansed and made new and washed and come up. And when I die, I'm truly going to be alive. It's as simple as saying, yeah, I've died to myself now, and I live for him. But when I die, when this body dies, I'm going to live forever in heaven because I'm made washed new. How many of you guys say that's a pretty good hope, right? And when you get baptized, you declare. It's like you're preaching for Jesus. No, I can get up here and preach. I'm a pastor. It's what I do. But when you get baptized, you're part of one of the greatest sermons that could ever be preached. And if you haven't been baptized yet, we're going to be doing it the week after Easter. And I encourage you, take out your blue card and just sign up. Say, hey, I want to be a baptizer. It's right there. Give us your first name, last name, all this stuff. You just show up. You can go to our website and watch a quick little video. It tells you about what to expect. We hold you under for about a minute or so. So practice in the bathtub. No, it's awesome, you guys. It's quick. It's so simple. It's awesome. If you have not been baptized, I'm telling you guys, Laura and I, we were baptized on March 17th, 1991. And it was amazing. I am so glad that I did it. And I'm going to tell you, it's one of the most amazing things. Sign up. We'll get you information. And that's just a way of spreading hope and telling people about the hope that you found. And as well for you parents. How many parents want to have the sense of hope in your life? As parents, raising your kids, right? That's why you dedicate your kids, because you're saying, I am hoping, I'm placing my hope in this God, that if I raise them in the way that he does, then he is going to penetrate their life and their hearts. Our hope is placed in him. If you haven't done that, we're doing that on Mother's Day. Sign up for that. There's what we like to do at this church, if you haven't found out, we like to exercise the things of hope. We like to exercise the things in Christianity. We like to be spiritual. We don't like to be spectators. Amen? We like to get involved. Do this thing, right? And that's what it's about. And so we want to explore today are these things. What is this hope? What is the hope that God has given us? What is this God of hope? Who is this God of hope? What is the hope that he gives despite what we think hope is? I'm going to say that again. What is the hope that he gives despite what we think is hope? Write this thing down. What do we need to do? We need to do this. Leave the tombstone mentality. Look at somebody next to you and say, leave the tombstone mentality. Okay? So, this is a tomb. And it's covered up. And we live with this tombstone mentality. See, there are people who live as if their lives are tombed up. They're locked in. They're dead. They're done. They're through. And they get this way because something has happened that didn't go as they planned. Oh, they're saved, but they get caught back up in this tombstone mentality because things didn't go they wanted. They get that way when problems happen. So essentially, they lose hope. It's easier than you think to lose hope. You just find something meaningful enough to you to be gone. And your hope's going to be tested big time, huh? Right? You find something meaningful to you, and your hope will be tested. And you're going to decide right there what your hope is in. See, when things don't turn out the way that you wanted, it's hard to accept that sometimes. And it's kind of like this poor little guy. How many guys ever feel like scrat? You just feel like scrat sometimes in life? Like, are you kidding me? I was right there! I've done everything right! I mean, you're just about there. He just looks so distraught, that poor little guy. And I mean, he always just gets so close and always starts off where he has this hope and he's alive again. Yes! Yes! And then he thinks it's finally it, but then, oops, not this time. It just seems like he goes back into what I call the tombstone mentality, where he's locked into always just being the loser. Some of us feel that way in our relationships. Some of you that are single. I want to tell you, this church loves our singles. We embrace our singles. We're okay with you being single. You don't have to get married for God to love you more. We understand that being single in today's world can be tough and it can be hard. And we want you to know this is a safe place. And we are putting together more and more things and ways for you guys to get connected to each other. Who knows? Some may be married. No, I'm just teasing. But we know there's real struggles there. There's that longing to want to be with someone, but sometimes it's hard to find someone to want to be with. But, you know, living life like there is no Easter, Jesus has provided true hope for us. So now, we are to look at our lives differently. We are to look at our lives differently because of this hope. You know, what you do is you see your situations differently. Living in the living hope. That's what you begin to do. You begin to think differently, act differently, hope differently. See, stop living as if we have no hope. Understand that right away. Did you guys hear that? Stop living as if there is no hope. At times, you will feel hopeless. Has anybody ever felt hopeless before? Has anybody ever given their life to Jesus and before felt hopeless? Raise your hand. Amen, right? And so at times, you feel hopeless, but is that the truth? Is the truth is that you are hopeless? No. And that's the difference. You might feel hopeless, but you remind yourself of the truth is that I'm not hopeless. Even if the situation doesn't turn out the way that I want, it doesn't mean that I'm not hopeless. It means that I have a hope that I can place in another format that God has for me. So at that moment, you begin to realize that you need to leave that tombstone mentality because it's a trap and it will rob you of all the good things that God has planned. Did you know that God has a plan for you on this side of heaven? You get saved, and it says He has all the days of your life right now for you. He has incredible plans, but this tombstone is not a part of His plan. And sometimes we just go right back to it when things go wrong. And so how? You're like, Pastor Chuck, that's great. How many of you guys want to leave the tombstone mentality today? Anybody here? Come on, raise your hand. You want to leave the tombstone mentality in your marriage? You want to leave the tombstone mentality in your parenting, in your life, in your work? Anybody today? Come on, because we're going to get to it today, amen? We're going to have church, we're going to get to it, and we're going to cut through all the junk and all the garbage that the devil and ourselves and the lies that we live in. And we're going to get to the truth today, and you're going to see the power of what Easter is, amen? So here's how you do this. Here's three key ways to leave the tombstone mentality. You see, we have hope because of what Jesus has done, but do we walk in it? See, hope is one of the most vague things. As a preacher, it's probably the hardest topic to preach on. Because hope, if you know how to define it, or how to describe it, or even to discuss it, it's often confused with faith. Is faith hope? Is hope faith? Is it, you know? But faith makes us sure what we hope for. See, faith makes us sure what we hope for and gives us proof of what we cannot see. So how do you walk? How do you live? How do you walk in hope? Well, the first thing is this. Write this down. A, through problems. Each of us experience problems in life. Romans chapter 5, verse 3 says this. Read this out loud with me. Ready? Together. We can rejoice, too, if we run into problems. Let's try it again from the top. We can rejoice, too, when we run into problems and trials. It's going to happen. Now listen, the word problem is defined like this. A matter or situation regarded as unwelcome or harmful and needing to be dealt with and overcome. How many guys, doesn't that word overcome sound familiar this morning? How many guys appreciate our worship team, amen? You know, trials, the word trial, it's a test. Something especially, you know, if you're going to test a new product, to assess its sustainability and its performance. So what is this saying? It is said that, you know, look, you can try and, what the Bible is saying is you can actually brag about your problems. They're saying you can rejoice. You can brag. Did you hear about what's going on in my life right now? You're not even going to believe this. This is absolutely amazing. We're losing our house. I gotta tell you, this is great. I mean, this, go tell everybody that I'm losing my house. Now, that seems crazy, doesn't it? Doesn't that seem crazy? Some of you guys are like, this guy is cuckoo. He was out with the youth group, he was up too long. Put him to bed, right? And part of that might be true, but But it's saying we could brag about our problems. Not that you have to be happy for the particular problem, but you could brag about the problem. Because you can have hope in problems because I know that there is an opportunity for God to work in my life. And for me to experience God's love and grace as He works in my situation. Now, I want to stop for a serious moment real quick. I don't want us to be one of those churches, and I'm not one of those pastors, that if you have a problem, that you got to fake it. Hi, Pastor. I'm losing my house, but that's okay. Okay? That's not what I'm saying. Okay? I'm kind of joking here, right? What I'm saying is you can rejoice, meaning that you can have hope. Okay? You don't have to be happy about it. God's not like, you're not happy about losing your house. What's the matter with you? I'm not too happy with you. I want to see your happiness levels elevate with that losing of the house situation. Okay, let's work on that. All right, even if you have to fake it, I want you to be fake. Is that how our God is? No, right? So that's not what I'm saying. What we mean by rejoice is be like, this is not good. I don't like this, but I can find hope in this somehow. Because I know my God has a plan in it. Now, because He's going to work in our situations. And as I see the work of God completed, my hope just gets stronger. Look at Romans chapter 5, verse 5. And this hope will not lead to disappointment. For we know how dearly God loves us because He has given us the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts with His love. Sometimes the only thing that you got in your life when you're going through something is the Word of God and His Holy Spirit to tell you, I'm here. Sometimes you don't even hear it's going to be okay. Sometimes you just hear, I'm here. That's why He's given us the Holy Spirit. I want you to circle this hope. Circle this hope. I want to tell you that I'd be lying to you if I said that hope has never disappointed me. Has God disappointed me? No. Have I been disappointed with God? Yeah. It's not God's fault. It's my understanding of God. Has the hope that God has disappointed me? No, but have I been disappointed in it? Yes. And have I had to learn what hope is? Yes. Have I had to learn what God is and what His hope is at times? Yes. And see, what I've learned to do is I've learned to ask the right questions when I get disappointed. When I've hoped in something and I've prayed in something, I've learned to ask the right questions. And so when disappointed, ask yourself these three questions. Number one, is my hope in what I want God to do? Listen to your prayers. That's the power of writing your prayers. The other day, in one of my journals, I got journals all over. I got like 80 journals. I got like one in every drawer, one in every Bible. It's just ridiculous. And I go, oh, wow, I haven't written in this one in 2 years. What was I doing then? You know, it's funny. I read one about 2 or 3 years that I haven't written in like 2 or 3 years. And I'm like, wow, a lot's happened. But one of the things I like to do when I read my prayers, my talk with God, is I'm looking at what I'm praying. And is my hope in what I want God to do. The second thing is, the second question to ask is my hope in what God can do? Okay? Those are good things. It's okay to, you know, put hope in what you want God to do. It's okay. But you don't leave it there. That's not the only place where you put hope. It's okay to place your hope in what God can do. Is there anything wrong with believing that God can heal? No. Is there anything to believe that God can turn around the life of this person that is mean and angry and needs Jesus? No. Place your hope in that. But another thing to ask, and this is the one that we don't ask, is this, third one, is my hope in what God will do. That's the kicker. That's the one. When I'm sitting and I'm talking to someone and they're telling me what's going wrong, what's happened in their life, and I'm hearing them, in my mind I'm thinking, what have you been praying? I love that. I ask them, what have you been praying? And I go, what do you think? And then I tell them, I say, did you hear that? And they go, no. Well, let's go over your prayers. You're missing something. What? Man, you got great faith. That's awesome. I wish I had your faith, actually, sometimes more. But what if we stretched your faith a little bit more, broadened it? Have you been praying what God will do? So you look at Jeremiah 29:11. For you know the plans that I have for you, says God. What to say? For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Does it say anywhere that you'll never go through problems? No. How can you be prospered if you have to go through a time where you need to be prospered? How can you find help if you need to go through a time where you need to get help? See, what hope is the Bible talking about here? This hope that we circled, this hope that we're talking about, this hope will not disappoint us. And I can tell you that. The hope of God will not disappoint us. You might get disappointed with it, but it won't disappoint you when you hope in Him. Is your hope in the things of Him, or is your hope in Him? Who He is, what He has, in the plans that He has for you. That's the difference in what His will is, not mine. Look at Luke chapter 24. It says this. Now, real quickly, stop. Don't read it yet. Jesus had died, okay? 3 days later, He rose. And everyone's crazy. You remember what happened? This Jesus died. He says He's going to be Messiah. All this stuff. And it's the morning. The tomb was moved, and Jesus is alive. And I just want to see if you could catch what's going on here. Okay? People are talking about it. Now look at this now. Ready? Jesus Himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing Him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" This is the morning that He rose from the dead. They stood still, their faces downcast. And one of them, named Cleopas, asked Him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened in the last few days?" "What things?" He asked. This is Jesus in disguise, right? Just kind of hanging out with them. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed Him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified Him. But we had hoped that He was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, this is the third day since all this took place. And then Jesus revealed Himself to them. Did you catch that? We had hoped. But was their hope the plan that God had? Was it? No. And that's how some of you are living your lives. What's wrong? Well, you know, I was going to church, told God I'd live for Him and give Him everything, and I had hoped, you know, that my marriage would go okay, but my spouse walked out. You know, I had hoped that God would heal so-and-so, but He didn't, so I guess it doesn't happen. See, despite what He can do, we are called to submit to what He will do. I'm going to say that again. Despite what He can do, we are called to submit to what He will do. So what about doubt then? What about doubt and faith here? Okay, what about it then? I just ask it right back. What better to do with your doubt and your faith than submit it to the will of God? Do you see how easy it is? We make it hard. Jesus showed us the power of faith. See, when you have enough faith to even pray about something, I say that's pretty good. Have you ever been so distraught sometimes that you didn't pray about something when you know you should have? Okay, that's defeat. That's doubt defeating you. But when you have enough faith, just a bit, is that faith to pray? I think so. I mean, I'll give you credit for that. I'm not God, but I say, if you're asking, that's a start, right? At least that's a start. Look at this. Jesus replied in Matthew 17, "Because you have so little faith, I tell you the truth. If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, 'Move from here to there,' and it will move. Nothing will be impossible for you." Nothing is impossible for us, but also God has a plan in this stuff. I mean, did you hear that? Jesus was telling us how powerful faith is. He was telling us how powerful faith in Him is. Look, if we feel weak or we feel powerless as Christians, we should examine our faith. I'm going to say that again. If you feel weak, feel powerless, acknowledge that. Begin to talk to yourself. Talk to another brother or sister in the Lord. Begin to look at what you're writing. Express some things. And, you know, why am I feeling this way? Make sure that we are trusting not in our own abilities to produce results, but in God's. I said in the name of Jesus, I yelled really loud. I was growing louder than that person in my prayer. Doesn't that mean more? Right? I squinched harder. See, if we are facing problems that seem as big and as movable as mountains, we must turn our eyes from the mountain and look to Christ for more faith. But I want to stress, yes, guys, I want you to listen to me. I want to stress, yes, pray for and put faith in what you want God to do. God's not threatened by it. God's not like, oh, they misused it, and now I got to deal with this problem. It's not a magic wand, okay? Let him work with you, and it's part of a relationship. But I want to tell you, listen to me. Yes, please, please, pray for and put faith in what you want God to do. And as you read your Bible every day, you'll actually grow in what God wants to do a lot of times. But in what you want God to do, as long as it agrees with his word, amen? Okay, yes, pray for and put faith in what God can do for you. Amen? God, I'd like this, but I know that you can do this. I know your word says that you can do this. You are a God that can do that. Amen? Should we be praying fervently on that stuff? Huh? Right? Just because it didn't happen one time before, does it mean it's not going to happen this time? No, because God can do it. So pray. Go for it. But ultimately, pray for and put faith in what God will do. You see, that's not a doubt mentality. To me, that's a servant. That's a submitted mentality. You go through the steps. Yes, God, I want to see you do this in my family. God, I want to see you touch my kids. I want to see you transform them. I want to see them spirit-filled. I want to see them living for you. I want to see them take this world over for you with a relentless pursuit. Is that good stuff? Guys, this on? Is it working? I think everybody went on the trip with the youth this weekend. Come on, give me some back, guys. Is that good stuff to pray on? Amen. Okay, so that's what I want God to do, all right? How about this? Lord, I know that you can help us in this situation. I've seen it in your word. I've seen you do it in others. I know that you are able. Would you come and meet us, God? Is that a good thing to pray? Okay, then how about this one? Lord, I want to see you touch my family. I want to see you do this. God, I want to see you do that. I have this. God, I know that you can because I've seen you do it in others' lives. I've seen you have these things. But then, Lord, no matter what, I am yours. I'm yours no matter what. How about that? See, God doesn't disappoint. In problems, God is trying to show us and he's trying to teach us the story of our life. It's not done yet. Hope isn't lost and it's not gone as a whole. See, during problems, we learn that we need God for more than salvation. But for our whole lives, we grow spiritually because we press on despite. Say despite. That's one of the most powerful words, despite. I love that word. Say despite. It's a good word. Despite. But we learn to press on despite. We pray harder. We pray bolder, we pray more faithfully, and we believe God for his wisdom and for his provision. So in times of hope, study the word of God. Memorize the word of God. Soak in the songs of worship and hope and learn to surrender in him. I want to tell you guys, that's why if you haven't signed up for ACT, would you please do it? What else are you going to do on a Sunday besides take a nap, right? You're going to go home and eat lunch, and you're going to take a nap, all right? And then you're going to watch some TV. Why don't you give me a few hours of your time? And we'll do the first of four ACT classes. Act one, it's about what a church is. It's about church membership, why God made it, what we do in each other's lives. You're going to learn about me. You're going to learn the very first step of how to ACT, how to accurate Christian training, how to act like a Christian. How many of you guys like to know more how to act, how Jesus wants us to act? Anyone? How many of you guys think it's a good deal if we're going to feed you for free and watch your kids for free? I'm going to say, that's a pretty good deal. I think I'll be there. And I'm going to teach you. Amen? Sign up today. Fill out this card right on the back. I'm going to be there. My spouse is going to be there. My three kids, give us their ages, are going to be there. We are coming to come and grow. Amen? And leave it on your seat. Let us know so we can, you know, be prepared for you and you can be prepared to grow. You will gain tremendous strength to draw from when you go through these problems that you never would have otherwise. Guys, Romans 5:3, what's it say? We can rejoice too when we run into problems and trials. It says problems are opportunities to praise because though there may be tears and pain and turmoil and lots of loss, the gain is eternal. The gain is a trust in God like you never would have had before. It's an intimacy with God like you never had before. How many guys can say problems draw you closer, right? It's the closest that you never would have had. You know, there's just something about war buddies. There's just something about war buddies. I love talking to people that have been through war, even been in the military together, or people that went on an excursion together and they almost died, or they really went through something. That's the power. You heard these students today talking about kind of the journey that they went through together. But there's just something about war buddies. Something about the bond created when you go through battle together. Yeah, you win some and you lose some, but you made it together. And that's the greatest bonding time is going through a tough thing together. That's why way too many marriages quit too soon. We fight all the time. We can't stand. I can't even stand the way he chews his food. I can't even stand the sound of her voice. Hi, honey. How you doing? Praise God. You're going through war together. Don't fight each other, fight the real enemy, amen? That's my war buddy. My wife and I are going to be together for 25 years. Not married, but we have been together for 25 years on April 4th. Next Saturday. And I actually love you more than I ever have. I really do. Because she still loves me. That's amazing. She could get like a prize or something. I don't get her gifts. I give her prizes now. Here you go. You're amazing. Trophies, all kinds of things. But see, God knows about the war buddy mentality. God knows that, and though he doesn't cause all that we go through, he allows some of what we go through because then he and I create a war buddy bond. This is my God. He is faithful. He is just. What I read in my Bible, I've lived some of those things. A deep, deep, close bond. He's out to have a relationship with us, not a romance.
Who is he? He does all that I ask. He spoils me. He must really love me.
He doesn't want that with us. The reality is at times you may start losing hope in what you want, but you gain hope in what God wants and what God has. That's intimacy. So go on and believe God for healing, for an answer, for the supernatural intervention for what you are praying for. Yes, but those times come when those hopes die because it doesn't happen as you and I have prayed. And I want to tell you, it's devastating. It's devastating at that moment. You had faith, and you have your hope tested. And you think, all the prayers that I've prayed, all the scriptures that I memorized with this, all the sermons I've listened to, all the songs I raised my hand in faith in, all those people that I've enlisted to pray for me, all the faith that I had, all the worship I gave, all of it was pointless and it was stupid. You can feel disappointed. You can feel bruised. And at that moment, what do you do when hope doesn't turn out as you expected? You can give up on God. That's part of my testimony. There was a moment in time, my senior year, that I walked away from God because I got hurt. Somebody hurt me. Jesus was hurt. But you can walk away from God and give up. And you can say, he's a sham. Or you can beat yourself up. If I had stronger faith, if I was a better Christian, if I prayed more, or does God actually know what he's doing? And you are actually now a better Christian because of what you went through. And it's then, listen to me, And it's then that you go into a hope rebuilding campaign. Did you hear that? It's at that moment that you go, I'm going to begin a hope rebuilding campaign. And you place your hope in the living Creator, Lord God of the universe's will. And you say, I trust you. No matter what, I trust you. I don't have to like it. I'm not called to like it. I'm called to submit to it. Amen? So the first is through problems. B, write this down. Through delay. So we see God's help helps us to leave this tombstone mentality as we embrace the problems to the point that our hope is in what He ends up doing. But also, in that time of delay, we're going through it. Say, through it. Right? We like to just go through it. But sometimes you're going through it. Right? Have you guys ever played that game like you hold your breath when you go into a tunnel? You ever done that? Okay, well, there's sometimes. Or over a bridge. You ever done that one? Right? I've been over the Golden Gate, the Bay Bridge, and all that stuff. Sometimes you go, all right, here you go. And you go, right? Ah, that'd be that nice little bridge, you know, right, just right over, you know, like 6th Street or something. But sometimes you're like, we don't want to go through it. You just want to go through it. Right? But sometimes that's life. What's going on? Sometimes, I love that somebody's saying, how you doing? Say, man, I'm going through it. I don't know if you guys say that out here, but sometimes we say that in California. How you doing? Man, I'm going through it. Going through it, dog. Right? I'm not a dog. I mean, do I smell like one? I know, I was panting. No, just, but, you know, man, I'm going through it. You know, it's okay. We should start a saying here. How you doing? Man, I'm going through it. Right? It's okay to do that. Because then people know, oh, I know where you're at. I know where you're at, dog. Right? I know right where you're at. I've been there. And guess what you did? You just enlisted somebody to pray with you. Oh, I know exactly what you were. Man, thank God you weren't fake. How you doing? Oh, just going through it. And really inside, you're going through it, right? So let me guys say, let's make an agreement. If somebody asks how you doing, and you're really actually going through it, it's okay to be real. Amen? All right? So let's practice it. Hey, how you doing? I'm going through it. All right? And you got to take a real big deep breath and go, I'm going through, turn into a song. Oh, it. You're like, yeah, you are. Man. Woo! Well, sometimes that's what's happening to life. Oh, I feel bad for you guys. ADHD, it's a wonderful thing to watch. I think it's a spiritual gift. I mean, it's been working for me. I don't know. That through it thing was not in my notes. I'm just telling you, it was all God. It's God. It works. I want to remember that one. But also, as you're going through it, we're changing. Romans 5:3, read this out loud with me. For we know that they help us develop endurance. What helps us? Problems. The things that we're going through. See, endurance is patience. It's waiting on God. Because I have hope in Jesus Christ, I can face the reality of life with confidence that God has a purpose now. We glory in these trials. We hope that God can get glorified in it, that we could be examples of His glory, that we could draw closer to His glory. I glory in the trials because I've learned that even in trials, there's opportunity for God to manifest Himself in my life. You want to know one of the number one things that God has given you to bless you for times of endurance? You ready? A lot of churches don't talk about this. I'm going to tell you right now. It's the people sitting in this room. One of the greatest things to help you get through those through at times, those learning patience times, is actually other believers, other brothers and sisters in the Lord. That's why we do life groups. Say life groups. Okay? You heard me say last week, we don't go into prison together, cell group. No, you can call it whatever you want. I don't care, right? Or small group. We're just three. But we call it life groups because we go through life together. It's a place to be real and say, how you doing? I'm going through it, right? I'm having problems. Things are going great. People to pray for one another, help one another, encourage one another, visit one another. Just do life together. So when you got joys, you got people that can mourn with you, rejoice with you, celebrate with you, praise with you, build you. You build them, keep you accountable, love your kids. You love their kids. It's hard sometimes, but you love their kids. No, I'm just kidding. My kids are the ones who are like, hi, the Rudas. But you see what I'm talking about? You need people to go. That's why God gave us each other. But I see churches going, hi, brother, how you doing? What's your last name? I don't know. You need people. If you are not in a life group, before you go to, I want to see these blue cards filled today. And I'm going to tell you this with love. You ready? If you're not signing up for what we're trying to do to help disciple and build you, I can't help you if you're not going to help yourself. This is the help time now. This is what I do. Amen? So with that, sign up for a life group. It's on your blue card. On the 12th of April, right after people have been dunked, we're going to have a potluck. Bring some food, and I'm going to put you in a life group. Okay? We're going to get into a life group, and then right after that, we get you in your life group, then you're going to have your potluck at tables with the people that are in your new life group. You guys think that's a good idea? Right? It's a great thing to start. Just get to know each other. You know what a life group isn't? We're afraid that, you know, life groups are like, everyone's going to know everything about me. Oh, no. Right? Just calm down. Be cool, my babies. It's going to be okay. I got a curriculum that's on video that I'm going to lead you in. It will be okay. All right? So everybody take a deep breath. Hold it. Let it out. How many guys say, I need others and others need me? Amen? When I'm going through the delay. So what we see here is I have learned when there is pressure, when there are problems, that I need to just wait on the Lord at those times. It took me a long time to learn this. Romans 12:12. Rejoice in our confident hope, be patient in trouble, and keep on praying. Okay, I got to be patient. God's delaying here. There's something going on. I understand. Sometimes it's the enemy. But sometimes it's going to endure you to get through what the enemy's doing. Because God's taking him out first. God's like, I'm taking care of this sucker right now, but just hold on. And you're like, okay, God. Sometimes God is doing things that we can't see. Can I tell you that what I learned 2 years ago while waiting for God to bring us to this church, what church God will lead us through, it was this. And my hope was tested. Because Laura and I felt like God gave us a very specific understanding of what he wanted to do in us and through us and where he wanted to lead us. And we learned that in God's delay, it doesn't mean he's denied us. But oftentimes, he is creating and making his answers more detailed and with more definition. God could have just sent me anywhere. I could have went anywhere. There's a lot of places I could have went. But we just waited on God. And then I look at it and go, oh, look at the details. Look at the definition that God put into this thing. Romans 8:24, it says this in 25. But hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they have already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it what? See, it is in delay where my hope is elevated because it's according to God's timing. Did you get that? God's timing, that he is doing something deeper. See, there's another way to lead the tombstone mentality is through experience. Now, this kind of goes back to the war buddy thing. I just want to do something here real quickly. This kind of goes back to a war buddy thing, but I want to do this. If you have been serving the Lord Jesus Christ for over 30 years or more, would you please stand up right now? Wow, praise God. If you have been serving the Lord God for more than 40 years, just stay standing. Just raise your hand if you've been serving God for 40 or more years. Okay, if you've been serving God for 50 or more years, keep your hand up. 60 or more years. Now keep standing if you've been serving God for 30 years, okay? Wow. You guys seeing what I'm seeing? Praise God. I applaud each and every one of you, and I thank God for you. You are some of the richest treasures that God has gifted this church with. That God has gifted me with. The war stories of life and of Christianity and how hope and God's will and walking with the Lord has, it's filling your life more than you can ever even know that what we need. We need you guys. We need you. You are treasures. Please. We need to hear your, we need to hear your wisdom. We need to hear your experiences. Please, would you pour into all of us? Don't retire. Don't retire on us. Coach us. Please sit down with us. Tell us, hey, sit down for me. Come on, let's praise God for them. Don't sit yet. Hold on. I know you're like, I've been serving God for 30 years. I'm sitting down. Listen, sit us down. Say, let's talk for a moment. Tell us, hey, let's talk for a minute. Please have us over to your house. Come over to our house. Pour into us what God has poured into you. If I could tell you how many times Grandma Mildred sat down a long-haired 15-year-old boy like me that didn't know me, 80 years old. She was at Azusa Street. She said, hey, I want you to come and sit down here for a minute. Okay. And she would just speak God's word, speak truth, speak reality. Pour into me. Say, sometimes this is going to happen in life. Hey, I've been watching you. I think this baby's going on, but I just want to tell you something. I just want to pray for you. Keep praying. Just serve the Lord. The Lord is good. Just love Him. Put Jesus first. Amen? God bless you. I know you probably really want to be seated. Thank you. Romans 5:4 says, and endurance develops strength of character. Those that stood up are people that have strength of character. They have experience. There are people of character that have experience and haven't quit on Jesus. Wow. Isn't that awesome? They're the ones that haven't quit. They're the ones that stuck through it. Guys, this is a church where we honor, value, and incorporate what our elders, our spiritual grandparents on life and how to live life and what Jesus are. And I'm going to tell you something. You might be 60 and you might meet somebody that's 30 that's been living for God their whole life, and let that 30-year-old pour into you though you're 60. Because I'm not talking about how old your skin is. I'm talking about how old your spirit is. Amen? But there are also people that have lived life that can apply those things as well. We pour into each other. You know something? The older I get, the less I freak out. Anybody like that? Just the older you get, the less you freak out. Why? Because the more I've been through, the more I've experienced. And everyone has been the new guy. You ever been the new guy in a job or in a situation, right? And you have that task. Here's the new guy, and you got to do this big thing, and it's scary. But the more you do it, the less scarier it becomes. But the first time you do something, can it be scary sometimes? I mean, it could be really scary. Kind of like this kid. Oh, I love it. I love it. The older I get, the more I kind of get like Janice, you know? What? Oh, my God. Oh, that's crazy. Oh, my gosh. I'm sorry you're going through that. Let's pray. Right? You can't develop giving muscles if you don't tithe. You know why I learned to tithe at 15 years old? Because I'm very observant. I saw at 15 years old, I wasn't raised in church. I was just that kid that came. Nobody in my family went to the church. And I saw one of the men in the church give a testimony that he had lost his job, the economy was bad, he worked with his hands, and he was still tithing, and God miraculously was getting them. He had a family of three kids. He was getting them from week to week, and I go, praise God, that's my God. And I've never had an issue with it. And it's never disappointed me. We have never gone without. Now, sometimes we want a little bit more, but God has been faithful. You guys, faith isn't faith until you use it. I can go to church all I want, and I can say I'm a Christian all day, but until I start putting my faith into action, there's not much substance because I haven't used it. So how are we able to hope in the midst of trials? And it's because of what we know, because we've experienced these things. You see, as we wait upon God, we get to experience His faithfulness in new, fresh ways. As you go through these problems and these delays, we can pray and trust God. Romans 5:4 says this, and character strengthens our confident hope of salvation. See, that hope turns into confidence when we go through these things. Circle confident. Confidence comes through experience. Some of us are only as confident as the power that we have in His name instead of His plan. Jesus had the power to stop His own death, but He didn't because it wasn't the Father's will. You and I have the power over disease, over death, over demons. But sometimes people still die. Sometimes the job goes away. Sometimes the spouse walks out. God may have not have caused it, but just watch how God will use it. Let God help you develop deep roots, but that will only happen as you sometimes go through these problems and you experience delay, but you don't quit. And that's why we can do what James says in John, in James chapter 1. As we get ready to kind of begin this thing to a close, I want you to let the Holy Spirit get in to speak to you. But look at James 1, 2 through 4. It says, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance. Perseverance must first finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking in anything. How many of you want to be spiritually immature? How many want to be spiritually mature? Right? We don't want to lack anything, but you got to go through it sometimes. Sometimes you got to go through it. There's no other way. See, God is out to mature and to develop us. Philippians 1, 6, He started a good work. Read this out loud with me. Being. What's up? Being. That's an action. So now read with me. Ready? Being confident of this, that He that began a good work in you will carry it on to completion on the day of Christ Jesus. And what God starts, He always finishes. Circle right there in James where it says must finish. God is returning us to how He were created to be, not lacking anything, mature and complete. Sometimes you got to go through the desert to get to the promised land. God will use problems to get us through. I want you to hear what Peter says. Okay? As you get ready to shut this thing down, I want you to just listen. I'm just going to read it. This could be like a whole sermon series, what I'm going to read right now, these two portions of Peter. But I just want you to hear. If we had Peter here, one of the apostles that walked with Jesus, he's experienced a lot, he's been in ministry, Jesus has been away, and he gets to this point where he writes his letter to the church. And here's what this elder, here's what this man of wisdom, here's what this guy who messed up a bunch but didn't quit, who learned, experienced, went through it, here's what he would say to us today. Here's what he is saying through the power of the Holy Spirit. Praise be to God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. In this you greatly rejoice, though now, for a little while, you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trials. You know some of those people suffered? Death, persecution. That's what they went through. Anyways, verse 7. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes, even though they're refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. See, sometimes your praise flows from the delay that you saw God faithful in. Sometimes your praise flows when you didn't get your way, God got His way, and you're okay with it now. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, you believe in Him. And you are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. It's a relationship with Him. You're growing. And look at 1 Peter 5. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that He may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety in Him because He cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert, because your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, meaning the devil. Stand firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you, and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Part of suffering is just this life, what life will do, because this ain't heaven. Sometimes God will say no. I want you to listen to this. Sometimes God will say no, because that's the only thing that will develop hope and faith in you. God's goal is not to spoil us, but it's to strengthen us. Do you want God to be a Disneyland dad or a developmental dad? You want him to just take you to Disneyland or to strengthen you to go through life victoriously? You see, he's the potter and we're the clay. Yes, listen to me. We've been given power over all things. But that doesn't mean that all things be overpowered how we think they will be. There are times you can pray all you want. Look at me, guys. I'm getting real right now. This is many years of pastoring and walking with people. You can name it. You can claim it. You can grab it. You can blab it. You can speak it. You cannot speak it. All day, every day. You can go ahead and pump yourself up, shout louder than the guy next to you, and guess what? Sometimes God will still say no. Guess why? I don't know why. I just know he's sovereign. He's God. I'm not. And so by giving us his power, it does not mean we own his will. It means we submit to and are in his will. We're in his plan. Proverbs 19:21 says, I'm not smart enough to do things God's way. Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. You see, God has it all figured out. Did you know that? When you put your hope, submit it to God, because God has it figured out. He's not just guessing as he goes along. Read Jeremiah 29:11 with me. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. See, oftentimes our intentions are right and good, but they're not what God wants. Romans 8:28, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Jesus himself said in Luke 22, Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me. Yet not my will, but yours be done. You guys, he exampled all things. He's saying, God, this is going to hurt. And it's not just the physical pain. The worst part of it is all the sin that I'm going to take on. And I'm going to be separated from you. Sometimes we experience the power of God to experience something, to go through it. God is not sadistic. But he wants us to see in a world with free will that he is still with us. You guys remember Pastor Covington? His first wife, Evelyn, was a very precious woman of God. Just like Joan. I don't know. The guy's lucky. Pastor Covington and I just, we're lucky. I mean, God blessed us. Evelyn was just a great woman of God. See, Evelyn got cancer. And we prayed. We prayed our guts out. We had prayer meetings. We fasted. There would be people, someone speaking tongues in the middle of a service, and somebody interpreted, thus saith the Lord, she's going to be healed. I don't even know how many times that happened. Now, if you knew Pastor Covington, the way I knew Pastor Covington and Evelyn, you would think, if there's people that are praying by faith, it's them. I'm just telling you right now. Pastor Covington has taught me how to pray in faith. See, Evelyn, she still passed away. I don't have all the answers. I know the one who does, though. And I can tell you that Evelyn's healing on earth didn't come to pass the way that we wanted to. But I can tell you the ultimate healing, because of Jesus Christ, is one that she's living right now. And that's what we have. There are times it doesn't matter how much faith you have on the front side. It's about, will you still have faith on the back side? Sometimes God delivers you from a situation. Sometimes God brings you through it. And sometimes God delivers it unto himself by saying, this one's mine. If God says no, it's not because we've lost the magic wand. It's because he's God. So are you submitted to his will, that he is sovereign? Because I'm going to tell you, a life without Easter offers no hope at all. God, the worship team come up here. So why? Why would I take time to say that without Jesus, there is no hope? This thing doesn't turn out always the way we want, but we do have hope still. Because it's the end. It's the ultimate goal. Sadly, the end, we end up living otherwise in a tombstone mentality. I want you to write this down. Here's why I'm telling you this here today. Because the stone of hopelessness has been rolled away. Did you hear me? The stone of hopelessness has been rolled away. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the woman took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. And they found that the stone had been rolled away from the tomb. Jesus took our place when he died. He took the death that we were supposed to have. And he says, oh no, you don't, death. I'm the living God, and I am above all things. And you are not going to take my people. You will not take those that belong to me. And I'm not going to allow them to be encased in the stone anymore. I'm going to roll the stone away, and I'm going to break it. And no more are you going to hold my people in. They are free because I'm their God. The stone has been rolled away because of who he is. Amen and amen and amen. Because the tomb is broken open. I'm going to keep hoping. Because the tomb has been broken open, I am going to keep on hoping. In Jesus' name, I want you to watch this video and this song. And when you're ready, you let God rise you up today, no matter where you are. Watch this.
I try to hold on to this world with everything I have, but I feel the weight of what it brings and the hurt that tries to grab. The many trials that seem to never end, his word declares this truth, that we will enter in this rest with wonders anew. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings, that there will be place with no more suffering. There will be a day with no more tears, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, we'll hold on to new ways. I know the journey seems so long. You feel you're walking on your own, but there has never been a step but you've walked down all alone. Troubled soul, don't lose your heart, cause joy and peace he brings, and the beauty that's in store outweighs the hurt of life's sting. But I hold on to this hope and the promise that he brings, that there will be a place where no more suffering. There will be a day with no more, no more pain, and no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. But until that day, There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. There will be a day when no more tears, no more pain, no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more. We'll see Jesus face to face. There will be a day He will wipe away the tears. He will wipe away the tears. He will wipe away the tears. There will be a day.
Revelation 21. I heard a loud shout from heaven, the throne, saying, "Look, God's home is now among His people. He will live with them, and they will be His people. God Himself will be with them. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no more death or sorrow or crying or pain. All these things are gone forever." And the one sitting on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." And then he said to me, "Write this down, for what I tell you is trustworthy." There will be a day, and that's our hope. With every eye closed. Maybe today that hope begins with you saying, "I need Jesus to be my Savior. I need to give Him my life right now." Or maybe you need to recommit yourself to Him, that you walked away because of hope that was lost. Just slip up your hand right now. I'm just going to pray for you right where you are. Amen. It's a safe place. Anyone else today says, "Pastor Chuck, I need to give my heart to Jesus. I need to give my life back to Jesus. I need to ask Him to forgive me my sins." Anybody else here today? Amen. It's a safe place. Praise God. With all those hands that went up, we're going to say a prayer together with you. Because we're better together. We don't have you do it alone. And as you do this, you're just giving yourself to Jesus and letting Him take the rest. Let's pray this out loud. Jesus. Pray together, everyone. Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. And You're the only one. And even though I don't understand it all, I know that You will grow me and show me as I live for You and follow You with all my life. In Jesus' name. Now, here's the takeaway that I want you guys to get. Watch this. How many of you guys have hope in Jesus? Raise your hand. If you have hope in Jesus, stand up right now. If Jesus is your hope, then I want you to read Romans chapter 11, verse 14 with me out loud now. Read this together. One more. Read this out loud. Ready? "I hope in this way to make some of my own people jealous enough to be saved." Praise Him now. Amen. We have up here stacks of cards. You're going to take this hope for yourself, or you're going to give it away. We got 6 days to get all these invitations out. Please come up now to make your life be creating a jealousy in people. If you're going to give this hope for Jesus, say, "Jesus, I'm going to show, if I believe it enough, that I'm going to give it away. I'm not going to be ashamed of Jesus." Then come up here now and get your stack to give them away. Come up here now. Come on now. And stay up here after. We're going to pray.